Hi, I'm Pod Guy.
And I'm Pod Gal.
And we're the Pod Couple. I like horror movies.
And I like felt crafting.
I like drinking beer.
And I like beer.
Don't those humans piss you off?
Oh my god, the world is such a wonderful place. Woo-hoo! And I really want to go to a poetry reading.
And I really want to go to a wet t-shirt contest.
And we're the Pod Couple.
So join us, the Pod Couple, on iTunes,
Stitcher Radio, Google Play Music, and wherever you find your podcasts.
The Pod Couple.
Two geeks, two beers, and a laptop. Episode 29, Lost, the Unanswered Questions.
Yet. Cheers.
Cheers.
Well, hello and welcome to a brand new episode of Two Geeks, Two Beers and a Laptop with me, Tom, and Morgan.
Hello. About time.
Yeah, episode 29.
Ooh.
Which is pretty impressive. This time I'm taking the reins to discuss one of my all-time favourite shows, Lost.
Mm.
So, your opinions?
Do you know, I enjoyed Lost. I know it's a controversial series, a divisive series. lots of people have lots of thoughts on it. But this isn't actually the first time you've recorded a podcast about Lost, is it, Tom?
I was hoping you'd forgotten. back when I used to do my masters in radio production, me and my good friend Mog McIntyre, who's kicking it now in BBC, doing really well for himself.
Sure. and you're recording Two Geeks, Two Beers on a laptop, so...
We did a show called The Lost Lockdown
podcast. Lost Lockdown.
And it was like one of the first few podcasts I used to do. And it did pretty well. There was like a few Lost forums and things that got posted on. It did alright at the time. Still gets downloads, so when I look at the stats and things, because it's still available.
So fans of The Lost Lockdown,
yeah.
Tom has returned to the fray.
To my roots.
Exciting.
I know.
So here we are, Tom and Morg, fresh into another Lost Lockdown, this time for episode 4, The Substitute. Well, we have, in summary, a Lock-centric episode. It appears the island is some glorified job interview for the Keeper of the Island, and we're getting into some dark versus light, good versus evil battle of powers.
Any of your original theories coming to fruition, do you reckon?
I think we've explained the smoke monster now.
Finally.
Yes.
At least we know sort of who he is, what he is, but why, when did he become that? That's what I want to know. Anyway, we'll get on to our nerdy theories at the end of the episode.
I always feel like, similar to like Man United, I always have to apologise for being a Lost fan.
Right.
I don't know why, but whenever I explain why it's one of my favourite shows, I'm like, Lost.
But it was huge at the time.
Yeah, I think it's one of those things where, I'll obviously get into it, but I think like people sort of gave up. You either stayed with it to the end, or you gave up after maybe halfway through season two, maybe.
Perhaps like Manchester United, it was it was huge at one point. Now you're slightly embarrassed if you're a fan of it.
Yeah. I'm no longer a glory supporter.
No.
I don't win anything. Anyway, well, this particular episode isn't about like, Lost in general. It's all
because
about...
Because it's a huge show.
It's
with
too big, if anything.
Many different facets. It would take hours and hours to talk about.
If anything, it's about kind of the unanswered questions that Lost left behind rather than the show itself. Because more than any other show, it's just so frustrating in its own way. I can defend it to my death.
To the hilt.
But there's just far too many things which still didn't really get a proper answer. So I'm going to go through each one.
All right. It says something that the unanswered questions alone will be able to material enough for this episode. So what's our themed beer?
Well, I was searching for anything to do with like soya. I did find a beer called... like brother something. I thought about Desmond.
Brother.
But I've gone with Oliver's Island, which is a nice golden ale.
Oliver's
Elfin
Island.
Sadly, no character in Lost called Oliver.
Oliver, but it is an island ale.
Yeah, exactly. So cheers.
Very good. Cheers.
nice big strong bottle, which I always like.
Right.
Yeah. So you were a fan in general.
I was a fan of Lost. Yeah. There was a lot of hype about Lost.
Yeah.
I remember
when really early on
when it began. Yeah. It was one of the first examples, I think, of a TV show where there was hype before it even. Well, I guess that is what hype is.
Yeah.
But you know what I mean? Most shows. Yeah. I think you know they would start. They would start in America, and then hype would build in this country. Whereas Lost, it was known as a big deal before it aired.
It didn't. I mean, it starred people who had done things before, but it didn't have any massive people in it.
But it was one of those. The show obviously it gone out in America, but it was on was it Channel 4 here
at first.
And they made a big deal of the fact that they had Lost. Yeah. There was a specially shot trailer that they had made
where
all the characters on the beach going, all of us are lost.
All of us have a secret. One of us is a hero. One of us is a fraud. One of us is a junkie. One of us is a cop. One of us is a saint. One of us is a sinner.
One of us is a martyr.
One of us is a murderer.
All of us are guilty.
All of us are lost.
Lost. The new scent from Calvin Klein. That's what that's like. It's like a fancy aftershave.
Channel 4 must have made that on the beach that it was filmed in. That's really, you know.
I haven't seen that since it first went out. I got all nostalgia juices flowing.
My favourite bit is Terry O'Quinn going, one of us is a martyr. A martyr.
I quite like one of us is a murderer as well from Domo, Dominic Monaghan.
Yeah. So it was a big deal from the start. And you either, as you say, stayed with it to the end through all the sci-fi bits and the time travelling and all that. I couldn't get enough of it. It was one of those shows where, through like season 4 or 5, at this point most people had given up. And I'd finish an episode and I'd go, that was...
I'd just sit down and go,
that was an incredible hour of television, that.
So I watched, I think, the first season and a bit, maybe, when it first went out. And then I did give up. But then someone I worked with, this guy was like, you got to watch Lost. It's incredible. And so I got back into it. And then I binged, sort of. I started again. And I binged from the pilot all the way up to sort of the end of season 5. And then watched season 6 as it went out.
Well, this episode does sort of require the listener to have watched and enjoyed Lost, I reckon. Though, I guess if you've downloaded and have started listening, chances are you're
a massive nerd, so you at least have a base awareness
but
of Lost.
If for some reason you're about to binge it from the start, having never seen it,
save this.
You might want to save this until you've finished. Don't like not listen to us ever again.
No, actually, do you know what? Listen now.
Yeah.
Then delete the episode. Yeah. Then go watch all of Lost. Yeah. Come back, re-download the episode, so we get double the hits.
I love the whole mythology, sci-fi-ness of it all.
Which built and built as the show went on.
Yeah.
Got more and more convoluted.
The reason it was so good, though, is obviously helped by its incredible like characters and, you know, the cast were interesting. Whereas shows that came since, like The Event or Flash Forward, they tried desperately to be like Lost, but you just didn't care about the characters.
No.
And it was just boring and whatever. That's why Lost got away with it in its own way. But I was totally obsessed. And it was one of the first times I was kind of aware of like TV fandom and wikias and all that kind of stuff. And like between season 5 and 6 in particular, that was where I just was every day going on like Lostpedia and trying to find out the latest theories and questions. Just
researching the Lost lockdown.
Constantly.
Yeah.
It was a long, long year.
Can I ask as well, was lockdown spelt with an E, like lock?
No,
like John Locke.
It was because of that, but it was also the hatch, you know, lockdown.
Yeah, lockdown.
Yeah.
So but there was an episode called Lockdown.
Yeah,
there we go.
See?
Layers.
But I also think you had to be a particular kind of person to follow Lost properly.
Right.
Like Game of Thrones, in a way.
A massive nerd.
You kind of, you need to know every single element of the show so far, and its mythology, and all the like the clever stuff behind the scenes, and you know, stuff you'd watch online, all that kind of stuff. Because if you don't, if you're a casual viewer, you're just useless.
So you need to have watched the webisodes and read the wikis. And
it's that kind of people that would... It was the bit at the end of season 3 where it was revealed to be a flash forward.
Yeah.
And...
We have to go back!
Yeah. We have to go back!
And then be people going, what? Jack and Kate knew each other all along? No.
Yeah, but I don't think that's anything to do with how much knowledge they had of the show. I think that's just stupid
people.
Yeah,
I think...
That's just stupid
people. I think if you're a certain level of stupid... And at the end, we'll go into it again later, but the church ending where they're all meeting up, they're like, well, they died at the beginning.
You still see, you see people
legitimate websites.
On legitimate websites writing articles about the end of Lost saying
they died.
They were dead all along.
No,
they weren't.
They weren't. Personally, I perhaps foolishly thought that kind of the writers knew what they were doing from day one.
Mm.
And I think I thought they had the whole story mapped out. Mm. And
we get
all the answers to all the questions answered by the end.
I remember famously, something that has never happened before or since, was where they were 3 seasons in, I think.
Yeah.
More or less, at kind of the show was at the height of its powers. Yeah. And they went, right, we're going to do something quite unprecedented here. We're going to say 3 more seasons all at once, but then done.
Yeah.
So... At least from, maybe, if not from the very beginning, at least from that point, you think they've got
three
years to plan, so you nail it down what's going to happen.
They knew exactly what they were doing, you'd think, because... Yeah. But then, even in season 6, they kept introducing characters like Alana, Jacob's maybe daughter,
she was supposed to be Jacob's daughter.
And she was boring and stupid and died instantly. And they kept introducing these other characters and people, and like, no, stop it, you're wasting time.
Yeah.
You've got literally like 10 episodes left, what are you doing? So it was very frustrating, and it's hard to sort of defend Lost in certain ways.
But the thing is, with Lost, there's a whole thing in Lost, right, about is it a man of science, man of faith?
Well, this is the thing. I wrote this, I'm very proud of it.
Yeah.
You had the constant battle between Jack and Locke,
which was at the heart of the show.
Yeah, so Locke was the man of faith, whereas Jack was man of science.
Yes, because he was a doctor.
And if you're a Lost person, you're either a fan of science or a fan of faith.
I think that's why you and I don't see eye to eye sometimes, Jack. Because you're a man of science.
Yeah. And what does that make you?
Me? Well, I'm a man of faith.
And so if there are some... And I'm a bit of both, annoyingly.
I think you're more a fan of faith.
Yeah. You're either a fan of faith where you enjoy the characters and the romance of it all, when the connections they make, and it's all about the emotion.
Because the finale, which is very, very divisive, I think on a purely emotional level,
it's perfect.
Is superb.
It's one of the best finales ever.
If you apply any level of critical analysis, intellectual thinking to it, it's absolute cotton.
If you're a fan of science, you want the answers and the mythology explained of all the things they built up. And I get it, because... And I'll get into it, how certain things were built up and then never explained.
Yeah.
And you'll see some people try and explain it off and go, ah, it just is. No, but you shouldn't have brought it up in the first place.
Yeah, no.
You know, you can't have that as a...
Well, I have a few of these. If you don't bring them up, I will bring them up. But right now, we're going to be fans of science. I'm going to apply some sort of intellectual thinking to
us. I'm going to be the uber nerd version, the twat element of this. And because I have grown angry about certain things about Lost. And I just wish they would sort of release a book, the writers, Damon Lindelof and Carlton Cuse. I wish they would release a book, just sort of go, okay, I'm really sorry, to prove that we didn't know what we were talking about. Here's every single thing with an official
answer. Or at least we're pretending like we knew what we were talking about now. So
They did at least make that bonus scene on the DVD, which is called The New Man in Charge, which after everything showed, Walt came back.
It revealed what happened to Walt.
Yeah. But even that was just 2 DHARMA employees... with Ben going up to them, sort of taking the piss.
Wait, you can't just walk out of here. We deserve answers.
All right. Before I go, I'll let you each ask a question. But just one, so make it count.
That was like Cuse and Lindelof trolling the fans to say, yeah, fuck you. Yeah? So, because people are like, oh, there's a bonus scene. We're going to find out all the little things.
Yeah.
Nah, not really.
Yeah. But you love this show, right?
I do. It doesn't sound like it. But so I put a list together of the biggest and most annoying unanswered questions that have always bugged me.
I've got to say, I understand. So, being a Doctor Who fan,
I
both love everything about Doctor Who and hate everything about Doctor Who. It's sort of you being a very passionate fan of these sorts of shows is a very unique proposition.
But do let us know if anything I'm saying is wrong.
Yeah,
if you've got answers to it.
Yes.
Because I do recommend a blog called Lost Answers by a man named Cody Johnston, who does set about answering every question possible with science and meaning. And a lot of it is interesting. He is also... Cody Johnson's also a bit shitty as well when he's explaining things. Because it's like...
He's a Lost fan.
So you go... There's some questions like, so why is this so? He's like, just is magic and that. Like, yeah, but that, why? Magic. It's magic. It's the island.
That is the answer to most things.
Yeah. So anyway, so we're going to go in my personal circles one by one.
All right. Okay. Okay. So, it's like therapy, I feel.
Yeah. So number one, Jacob's cabin.
All right.
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 So for ages, the only thing we knew about Jacob was his little cabin in the woods.
Mm.
Ben takes Locke, visits him, but Ben's doing it as a trick.
Yes.
He doesn't really know much about Jacob. You don't know this.
No.
But you find out later that he doesn't really know much about Jacob himself.
No.
Because he's never even met him at this point.
You don't know anything about the island, do you? You just made it all up.
Jacob, please, I can't hear him if you're going to talk over what he's
saying. Shut up! Putting on a show for me? Or do you really think there's someone there?
I know there's someone there.
You don't know anything. You're pathetic.
Help me.
However, Ben was as surprised as anyone when an actual magical force made itself known in the cave.
Okay, that's all sort of makes a logical sense.
So later, Christian Shepherd, which is Jack's dad, was later seen to be using it.
Are you Jacob?
I'm Christian, but I can speak on his behalf.
Claire?
Hi, John.
We don't have time for this. Why don't you ask the one question that does matter?
How do I save the island?
Also revealed that Jacob had actually been living at the foot of the big statue, the Egyptian statue, all this time.
Well, yeah, the statue that was never explained, but anyway.
So, who was actually living in Jacob's cabin this whole time?
What was the scary shit that Ben and Locke
Exactly. Because we later discover that Christian was actually the man in black, the smoke monster.
Yeah.
So, it appears he was at least, the man in black was at least renting the cabin.
Right. And on lease.
Yeah. But it was never specifically stated that this was so.
Right.
Which is a thing that Lost does all the time.
Yeah.
You just have to kind of presume things.
Implied.
Maybe the man in black for a time was stuck in there. There was an ash circle around the cabin for a while.
Okay.
And at one point you see Hurley disturb the ash and you think maybe that allowed him to leave. But surely he was allowed to leave all the time because we saw the monster all along. So how was he stuck in the thing?
Yeah, so
was it all just a trick?
So during that period where the smoke monster could have possibly been trapped in Jacob's cabin, we actually saw
a smoke monster
Christian Shepherd, who was like the physical manifestation of the smoke monster, plus the actual smoke monster all over the island. Presumably you'll get onto the whole Christian Shepherd.
Sort of.
So the smoke monster can't leave the island?
No.
Whenever Jack sees the manifestation of his dead father...
This is the thing, right.
It's the smoke monster you're meant to believe. And yet later, at certain points, Jack sees his father off the island.
Well, this is where we're going to get really deep. So another thing Cody Johnston has theorised is how you see two different versions of Christian Shepherd on the island.
Yeah.
One, you see him in a suit and the white trainers, which is what he was buried in in the cobbin.
In the cobbin.
And then you also see him in rags and shit. Now, when he's in rags, that's the man in black.
Right.
Because that's when he's being all, like, talking to Locke and shit.
Right.
But when he's, like, in his suit, he doesn't really say anything. He just sort of walks around this, you know, weird. And that, he has wondered whether that is actually Christian in the weird afterlife thing, going between the two worlds, trying to guide Jack to there.
Could have just been Jack going a bit crazy. Because he was a bit of a raging alcoholic as well.
Yeah. I feel like by season six, they were like, oh, Jacob wasn't in the cabin. He was just in the statue.
Why did they not keep a list?
A
list of questions to answer.
I know. But why did they introduce the cabin?
Well, because presumably they thought they would get around to it and then they just didn't. Explaining it away.
I think the only explanation for that is that it's just the man in black manipulating Locke to get to the point where he could come back as Locke's body and all that shit. You remember that?
Yeah.
But
why
go through the big ruse? Why just say words?
And but the thing about the man in black who was the smoke monster was trapped inside the cabin.
But he can't have been because we saw him all the time as a smoke monster.
So was he just, maybe he was just popping in and out of the cabin?
Yeah. Pretending he was trapped?
Yeah.
Pretending he was Jacob?
Yeah.
But why did Jacob at no point appear? And you're like, right guys.
No, it's me.
Jacob
that's
left
not,
the
that's
island all
me.
The time.
Yeah.
Why didn't he at no point appear and go, it's alright guys, I'm really sorry about this, but I just need to be really like vague all the time?
Yeah. Point number two. Let's move on.
Libby. Remember Libby?
Yes, she was Hurley's love interest.
Yes, so she was one of the tailies, as they were known.
From the tail end of the plane that crashed on the island.
So she appeared first in season two with Lucia and Echo and all those guys.
Yes.
Do you really think I can change?
Yeah.
And eventually got killed.
Yes.
By Michael.
By Michael.
Nothing to do with the fact that Cynthia Waitros was something to do with a driving
DUI. DUI, along with Michelle Rodriguez, who was also caught up in the same DUI. Mm-hmm. But we would not suggest that's the case because that would be libelous.
So just as Hurley began romancing Libby,
yes,
it was revealed at an end of the episode that Libby had actually spent time at the same mental facility as Hurley.
But before the island.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was revealed in some big, like...
It's like, has she been stalking
him? It was really sinister, and it turned around to Libby, like, sitting there staring at Hurley, like, she knew Hurley before, maybe she's there for a reason.
Has she been stalking him, or was some kind of weird fate brought them together?
Never brought back again.
Never mentioned again. Never mentioned again.
And I don't know if that's because Libby was written out early, because of the whole DUI thing.
Because that can't be the case, because that... Yeah.
But the way in which it was revealed made it seem like there was something weirdly sinister going on, and fans debated whether, you know, there was a reason for it.
Mm.
But killed off, Link was never explained. She did eventually return via flashback, which
one of Desmond's flashbacks.
Yeah, she explained to Desmond that her husband had died a few years previously. So although it was never explained, people have suggested maybe that's why she's in the facility due to depression.
Sure. So it could be just complete coincidence. Yeah. However,
and that's a running theme in Lost.
However. Hurley's quite a, and I don't want to be mean, but quite a sort of recognisable face quite a recognisable presence.
Yeah, so she simply didn't remember.
You'd remember that guy.
Yeah.
Dude, that's ridiculous.
But why introduce it in the first place is my point. Why introduce that as a plot point and then never, ever go back to it?
I feel like they were just sort of throwing intrigue at the wall and seeing what sticks, and then they were like...
It's just bad storytelling.
And again, you
had all that time to answer it.
Yeah.
You knew exactly when it was going to end. It wasn't like, oh shit, we've been cancelled. Mm. Fuck, we don't have enough time. Mm. Yeah, all the time in the world. Anyway.
This is Tom's favourite show, ladies.
This is my favourite programme.
Yeah.
Number three, the outrigger chase. Now, do you remember this?
Get out!
Battle!
Oh, yeah. So there was some... It was like Sawyer... And some other people.
Julia and a few people.
On a boat.
So it was where the island was moving back and forth in time.
Yeah. Because that was the thing that happened.
Yeah. And so they're in the water, in the ocean, and they were...
This occurs to me how fucking incomprehensible this episode will be to anyone who isn't...
But if you're with us, you know what we're talking about.
Yeah. If you're in this deep...
Yeah.
If not, you probably turned off 10 minutes in.
So... And a little bit drunk. So they keep flashing in time.
Mm.
They haven't got a Mac or anything, not showing off their bit. So Juliet, Sawyer, Miles, whatever, they're on a boat.
Yeah.
And then behind them, there's another outrigger, and they start shooting at them, but you don't know who's in the other outrigger.
Who's shooting at them?
And again, the way it was shown made it think, at some point we're going to find out who that was. Why else would they bother showing it? No,
never explained.
New, not a dull. Juliet even shoots one of them in the shoulder. You think, God, maybe it's themselves in the future.
That would be good. That'd be a good twist.
They shoot herself or something weird like that. But chances are, according to these things where people are asking questions, this doesn't matter.
What's our boy Cody got to say about this?
It was one of those ones where, that was his explanation.
Why is he putting so much effort into some of this, Cody?
He's just
shrugging off.
Yeah.
Mr. Johnston.
Or it was going to be revealed, but they ran out of time and they just sacrificed.
How much time do they need? They had 3 years.
I know. You know, Damon Lindelof himself did once say the real answer was meant to be revealed in season 6, but that's some of those in the outrigger had been killed off by that point, so they were like, don't worry about it.
Just so you know, I'm taking mental notes while we're doing this, so that the next time you pick on Doctor Who,
okay,
I can just throw any of this back in your face.
That's very accurate. Number four, Walt.
Walt!
So, if you're a fan of Lost,
you
must be sick to death of Michael shouting
for
name.
My boy, my son. Someone's made a compilation.
They got my son.
They got my boy, Walt. Someone's made a compilation of every time he says Walt, and it lasts for like 12 minutes. It's insane.
I will.
Walt.
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 I'm Walt.
Walt stays with me.
Walt.
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 So one of the earliest mysteries from the series is one that was never really explained at all. It was clearly
basically had that one from the off.
It was clearly early on that Walt had some kind of special powers, as you say. And
Walt, who was sort of the young boy on the island.
Yeah,
yeah.
And by the end of season 2, he had even like projected himself to various bits of the island. You saw him speak backwards,
like a astral projection.
Yeah,
chakras.
Chakras.
So he had as well. I remember there was a scene where he's like reading a comic book.
Yeah.
And then like a bird dies in the book. Yeah. And then a bird hits the window in real life. So it's like, oh, he can make things happen with his mind.
And the others were obsessed with him.
The others.
Which further increased the mystery surrounding him.
Only the thing is, we're going to have to take the boy.
But by the end of season two, Ben had let him and his dad, Michael, leave the island.
Mm. After Michael had killed those people in the DUI.
Mainly because...
He didn't kill them in a DUI, but he killed people who may or may not have been fired.
I mean, it's mainly because the actor Malcolm David Kelly had aged rather quickly and they had to get rid of him.
That's puberty, folks.
But his special abilities were never explained. So the answer to why Walt was special, apparently, just was...
Walton Whitmore used to be important!
And by the end of the series... You know, at that point, you know, Hurley could talk to ghosts. Yeah. Miles could hear dead people.
Yeah.
The island was all about a fucking magic light.
And so
in that context, it's like, and?
Yeah.
You know, he was special. He could do shit.
It was just people just had superpowers.
Yeah. It was just a shame that he didn't return in season six as a major character. Again, he appeared in that bonus scene when he was in a mental home. And again, not really explained, but he was in a mental home.
No. Never explained Walt's powers.
Yeah.
All right.
Number five.
I hope anyone listening didn't hope we were going to like go into the unexplained questions and explain.
Oh, yeah, I hope you didn't expect answers.
No, because
that's impossible.
That's not what we're here for.
No. We're as clueless as everyone. Number five, Eloise Hawking. Do you remember her at all?
Yes.
Played by Fiola Fan Flanagan.
I did not like that. I did not care for her.
No.
Because she killed...
Daniel Faraday.
One of my favourite characters, my boy, Daniel Faraday. Jeremy Davies. He was a great character. And normally, in TV shows, when you've got your established cast, and Lost was quite good at this in general, actually, you'd add new characters, and you'd be like, who's Johnny Newpants?
Yeah.
But Lost, I mean, my favourite of all the Lost characters...
Is Desmond,
who wasn't properly introduced until... I know he was a bit in it, but he wasn't properly introduced until season two.
Even then, it was only until season three he was a main character.
Yeah, and I loved Miles Strom as well. Yeah. He was great. And I loved Daniel Faraday. And
Richard Alpert.
Killed him.
You didn't like Richard Alpert, did you?
He's fine. but he's not on Faraday levels.
No.
So I love Faraday. So, and I was really annoyed when Eloise, it was his mum?
Yes.
Killed him.
Yeah.
You knew. You always knew. You knew this was gonna happen. And you sent me here anyway.
Who are you?
I'm your son.
And, you know, that bit, as tragic as it was at least quite clever. But Miss Hawking in general is utterly baffling. See if you can make sense of this one. She was a mysterious figure who played a big part in Desmond's journey back to the island after he turned the failsafe key.
Yeah.
I don't know what you're on about.
You don't buy the ring, Desmond.
How do you know my name?
Well, I know your name as well as I know that you don't ask Penny to marry you. In fact, you break her heart. Well, breaking her heart, of course, is what drives you in a few short years from now to enter that sailing race to prove her father wrong. Which brings you to the island where you spend the next 3 years of your life entering numbers into the computer until you are forced to turn that fail-safe key. And if you don't do those things, Desmond David Hume, every single one of us is dead.
So it was eventually shown that she was actually Daniel Faraday's mother, as you say.
Yeah.
And she was once the leader of the others.
Flashbacks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, they weren't flashbacks in the time when they were back in time. Back in time.
But what wasn't explained is how the hell she knew so much about all the kind of timey-wimey shit and how to get Jack and the others back to the island. Because she was the one that was instrumental in, like, you've got to get on this plane, you've got to make sure that there's the body of John Locke in the coffin, you've got to make sure you do all this.
I thought I said all of them.
This is all I could get on short notice.
Well, I suppose it'll have to do for now.
Why? How do you know all this?
How did she know all that?
You don't know.
You don't know.
For someone who was essentially a former leader of the others, and we know that most of them didn't know anything.
Well, Ben didn't know anything.
No, the leader of the others don't really know anything about Jacob or anything like that. They just don't. They just, they're just the people that have, you know...
Just live on the island.
They just live there.
Just
so how come she knew so much? Although one would assume she would be on Jacob's side rather than the man in black, she was actually hugely instrumental in Jacob's death because she was the one who made sure Locke's body returned to the island, thus allowing the man in black to take his form. I mean, maybe she was manipulated by the Man in Black, or or could have been against Jacob, just as she was against.
So maybe there we go. So maybe the Man in Black because he would have known the exact circumstances that would be.
But how did he get her the information? Because she was off the island, and he can't leave the island.
Yeah, but that's magic,
magic and island and shit,
and that's magic.
I mean, maybe she knew about the time travel stuff as a weird sort of power given to her by the Man in Black, like, you know, Richard Alpert was given that infinite life power by Jacob.
That's one of my if you're not going to bring that up, because the thing with Lost, even even the questions that they did answer, mm-hmm. it was just
that's the thing,
it was just magic in that.
Yeah.
So one of the big questions was, this character Richard Alpert, played by Nestor Carbonell, and he never aged.
Yeah.
So you'd see him in the present day, you'd see him in the flashbacks or in the time travel into the past scenes, and he'd be the same age. And for years, everyone's like, why doesn't Richard Alpert age? Why doesn't he age? Finally, there was an episode, and they were like, here we go, the answers.
Yeah.
And Jacob just sort of touched him and went, now you won't age.
Yeah.
That's not an answer.
That sums up Lost, really.
I never want to die. I want to live forever. That I can do.
They, I can't remember which way around it is, really. They explain sort of how, but not why.
Yeah.
So they explain how it happened, but not why that makes sense.
Yeah. Same deal with the Man in Black. It was like, how did the smoke monster happen?
I just did.
You ready for the answers? It's going to be great. Yeah. We threw him into a magic cave and then he just came out like that. And it's like, well, at least if you're going to do, you know, a completely nonsense explanation, dress it up in something. And like, just dress it up in some terminology that sounds better than that. Just say like, oh, it was the flibble dibble machine. We'll be like, well, I don't know what a flibble dibble machine is, so fair enough. But a magic cave.
Yeah. Well, so Eloise in general, because she kept appearing in all the, every time Desmond kept flashing, and he would go back, he'd go back in time and stuff.
anytime Desmond.
And
he would
meet her,
yeah.
and she would be instrumental in making sure he got back to the island, because if he didn't, the world would end.
Mm.
But it's like, well, how do you know? What do you know? And whose side are you on? Never explained.
How do you know? What do you know? Whose side are you on? This is the prisoner, is it? Whose side are you on?
Anyway, number six.
Oh, there we go. Very appropriate.
You are number six.
I want answers. You won't get it. It's very, very similar.
We'll be seeing you.
Yeah.
Whose side are you on?
That would be telling. We want information.
Information. Information.
You won't get it.
The sickness. Now, the sickness was a term used by many different characters in various eras. Mm. To the point where it's almost kind of impossible to know what exactly they were talking about. If it was the same thing.
Is this the deal with pregnantly?
It's all sorts of different things.
Right.
And that's probably the point.
Yeah.
So at one point, Rousseau, she was the first to talk about the sickness. She was that French lady. It was a bit crazy. We later found out through flashback that she crash landed on the island. And then, you know, she was the first to talk about the sickness.
Mm.
We later found out that, like, her campmates just slowly went crazy.
Yeah, I remember that.
You have only three choices. Run. Hide. Or die.
And then you also had Kelvin, who was the guy who Desmond shared the hatch with for years.
Oh, yeah.
He was like a DHARMA person. You didn't know who he was.
Yeah.
And Kelvin used the sickness as a trick to keep Desmond in the hatch at all times.
Yes.
And there were like occurrences of quarantine all over the place.
What was all that about then?
Just saving the world.
But all of this was totally separate to the childbirth issues.
Yeah.
More on that in a bit. But the actual sickness, apparently, was all down to how the men in... See, it's in fucking Men in Black. The Man in Black, the way he controlled people.
Yeah.
You know how when Saeed got claimed as a
when Saeed died and then turned evil.
But it was so weird. Because again, that was something which I think they were just taking the piss, because all that happened was...
Well, at that point, they had like five episodes left, and they were like, yeah.
But it was like, he's been claimed now. Like, Claire had been claimed now.
Yeah.
And all it was Sai just went a bit miserable for a bit. Because just at the last minute, he suddenly became Sai again and sacrificed his life, and it was great. So he hadn't really... Nothing had actually happened to him. He was just like, he just had enough at that point.
Yeah. I remember, though, like... Because at the end of Lost, they were, you know, obviously killing off all the characters. And some of them had really, like, sad and meaningful deaths, like Jin and Sun. It was really well done. And Arasai just sort of takes a bomb and just sort of runs off a bit and just gets blown off. Blown up.
Arasai is dead.
He just gets blown up off screen. It's like, I have been watching this character for 6 years. And he just sort of goes, see ya, boom.
Yeah. So the whole sickness thing was just up in the air.
Yeah.
Never given a full explanation as to if that's actually due to the Man in Black or if it's due to something else.
Yeah.
How he used it. Does he actually have any power? Did he actually infect people like Saeed?
Do you know what? I'm not a fan of this whole sickness plot.
No.
I'd go so far as to say, down with the sickness. if I'm honest. I'm being honest. Get up, come on,
get down with the sickness. Get up, well, one of those sickness things was my number 7 point, which is childbirth problems.
Yeah.
Which is totally unrelated to the sickness.
Right? Yeah.
So, in the island...
Because Claire, baby.
Yeah.
Stay away from my baby, Charlie.
Because women were unable to give birth without complications or even death for years.
Mm, on the island.
And this is why Ethan, do you remember Ethan?
Yeah, Tom Cruise's cousin.
Yeah?
Yeah.
He...
outside of the show.
He was obsessed with Claire.
Yeah.
And he wanted to carry out tests to make sure Aaron was born and all that kind of stuff. And in flashbacks, we saw how Juliet was brought to the island to fix the childbirth issue.
Yes, I remember.
But she was unable to do so.
Don't you understand that every time I try to help a woman on this island give birth, it hasn't worked?
Well, maybe whatever made that happen hasn't happened yet. You gotta try. You gotta help her. You're the only one that can.
However, Claire and Russo...
Which suggests it's like a medical issue. Or maybe not a medical issue, if she couldn't fix it. It's magic.
But Claire and Russo were the only ones who were able to actually have babies on the island without any problems.
Yeah.
Plus, Jacob and the Man in Black were also born on the island,
as
were presumably many others. So this suggests that there was a relatively small pocket of time where pregnancy issues began on the island, and only for those who were living there in that period. Yeah.
What was the deal with that guy who told Claire that she shouldn't get on the plane?
That was another thing on that Lost blog I talked about, where they were like, why did he do that?
Because she went to see like a psychic or something?
And he was like, you cannot go on the plane. It is imperative that it's imperative you do go on that plane.
Yeah.
And then his explanation was he was a fraud.
Cool. Okay, cool.
So he had nothing to do with anything. Yeah. It was just a red herring, essentially. That was just the writers just fucking with us.
Yeah. Do you know what, though? I don't think I've heard so many uses of the word imperative. Ever. Anyway, it's imperative that we move on.
So fans have debated that the issues occurred after the incident in 1977, which is where Juliet did the bomb.
Right.
Oh, you son of a bitch!
So that was because Miles
Strong,
as he mentioned already, and Ethan were both born on the island, but before that incident.
Was Miles born on
the
island?
Miles,
I don't remember
is
that.
The son of Pierre Chang, the Asian
was
man
he?
who yeah.
I don't remember.
You found
that
out in season 6 or 5.
I don't think she knew that by that point.
But since then, those who were on the island at the time of the electromagnetic surge have been unable to give birth without dying.
Right.
Alex and Aaron. Alex was Ben's daughter.
Mm.
Well, he wasn't actually her daughter. It was Russo's daughter that Ben raised.
Right.
They were born successfully as their mothers came from the outside.
Okay.
So they weren't conceived there.
But again, that's the how but not the why.
Yeah.
So
it makes sense.
So some EMP caused birth defects and difficulties. But why?
But why
wasn't
it confirmed? Just confirm it.
But also, and why would that happen?
But confirm it on the show.
Yeah.
Don't make us go, I think, stroke my beard, that's what has happened. Just tell us. Really, just tell us.
Tell us.
Anyway, number 8, the numbers. Right. Can you remember the numbers?
No, but don't look at your laptop. Go on, do it.
4, 8, 15, 16, 23, 42.
Have a look.
Yep.
Very good.
4, 8, 15, 16, 23, 42.
I can't see your laptop, so I'm presuming you're telling me this.
You'll have to just take our word for it that I wasn't looking at the laptop then.
He really wasn't, I swear.
So those numbers live long in the memory of any Lost fan.
Mm.
But did they actually have any significance whatsoever? Or was it just one big coincidence?
Because Hurley was given the numbers by a crazy guy.
Yeah, a crazy guy who heard it on a repeated signal, which was actually Russo's signal from the island.
Okay.
So a crazy guy heard those numbers... And it brought him nothing but bad luck.
Yeah.
And then Hurley heard about it, and then he went, fuck it, I'll use it as a lottery ticket. He won the lottery, and then he kept getting it bad luck and all this. And then the number was found on the hatch.
Yeah.
They're also...
Must have something that can surely...
They're also the corresponding numbers to Jacob's final 6 candidates. You know, Jack, Soil, the people at the end.
Yeah.
They were their numbers that Jacob had assigned to them.
Yeah.
They were the... This is really nerdy now, but they were the variables in the Valzinetti equation, which... DHARMA initiative we're obsessed with. You'd have to really look. I can't be arsed to go into that now. Just look it up. You know what I'm talking about if you're a fan.
in 1962, only 2 years ago, the world came to the brink of nuclear war. The United States and the Soviet Union almost fulfilled the promise of mutual assured destruction, a promise they continue to foster through a destructive Cold War. After the Cuban Missile Crisis, both nations decided to find a solution. The result was the Valenzetti equation. Commissioned under the highest secrecy through the UN Security Council, the equation is the brainchild of the Italian mathematician Enzo Valenzetti. It predicts the exact number of years and months before humanity extinguishes itself, whether through nuclear fire, chemical and biological warfare, conventional warfare, pandemic, overpopulation. His results are chilling, and attention must be paid. Valenzetti gave numerical values to the core environmental and human factors in his equation. 4, 8, 15, 16, 23, and 42.
And yeah, there were also the sequence used to do the hatch computer. Remember the numbers that they had to press into the hatch? They were the numbers that they had to do.
Which, that would at least explain why they were written on the hatch door.
Yeah, maybe. But they also appeared, those numbers, elsewhere. Little Easter eggs throughout the show all the time.
Okay.
Now, as we've already talked about, Locke and Jack fought over the concept of fate and coincidence throughout the series. So perhaps the numbers sat on Jack's side. Dharma's concentration on the Valzanetti equation probably led to them using it as a sequence of the hatch, while also transmitting them from the island, leading to Hurley using them for the lottery. So it was all one big...
So just coincidence. Yeah. The bad luck stuff was just coincidence.
So in the end, there's probably no magical connection.
Okay.
But rather
that's
just
the
one
best explanation I've ever heard for them.
The heavy use of the numbers early on just made them seem so much more important than they were.
Yeah.
Fine.
Yeah.
But say so. Because even now, we're going, was it all coincidence?
Yeah.
Probably.
Probably.
But tell us that.
Yeah.
All he did was some sort of flashback. He went, oh yeah, we just used that.
Clarification, please.
Number 9, probably the biggest of the lot.
Okay.
The mother and the monster
yeah.
and basically all of it.
Okay.
Right, so the big question. Yeah. So the problem a lot of Lost fans have by the end of the show is wanting more detailed explanations for the more scientific or magical stuff. So while the rate, as I say, all the writers, they gave us answers to why or what, they weren't so great at telling us how things came to be.
Yeah.
All the way around. I can never tell which way around.
I think it's we know how things happen, but not really
why it makes sense.
Yeah.
So Jacob and the Man in Black.
Yeah.
They're raised by Alison Janney.
Yes.
Known as Mother.
Yeah.
After she killed their real birth mother when she crash landed on the island.
Right.
Many, many years ago.
Okay.
Hundreds and hundreds of years ago.
Okay.
She then gave powers to both of them. Yeah. Don't worry how, she just did.
Yeah.
And she...
I just remember this episode clearly.
Oh, it was one of the worst episodes.
Because
of all
it was
time.
So good.
Yeah.
It was so good.
Oh, fuck me, it was stressful.
Beyond the Sea?
Across the Sea.
Across the Sea.
It was like the second
Beyond
or...
the Sea.
It was either penultimate episode or the one further from
I think
that.
It was, I think it was like the penultimate.
And it was meant to be like, oh my God, we're going to finally reveal everything.
Yeah.
And at the end of it, you're like, nope! Yeah. Don't understand a word of that.
Yeah.
Don't know what
famously... Stranger in a Strange Land, the episode that
that's
revealed...
That's the worst episode of all.
Although, I don't know, that revealed the secret of Jack's tattoos, which we're all itching to find out. But...
No, it explained how he got his tattoos, not what they meant. So even that, it didn't explain what
how
did.
How did he get his tattoos?
Yeah. I mean, he went to
tattoo
some
parlor, I imagine.
Island somewhere, and they did
But I think Across the Sea is an excellent song by Weezer, but possibly the worst episode of Lost.
So, she gives powers to both of them, hands her duty of the island caretaker job to Jacob.
Do you recognize this place?
Yes.
Do you remember what I showed you here?
The light.
You're going to protect it now.
What's down there?
Life. Death. Rebirth.
Shows him like the magic light that must never go out and all that kind of stuff. And we're watching this going, what the fuck is this? Why have we never seen any of this before?
Have they been listening to a lot of the Smiths? there is a light that never goes out.
So, okay, it's all hard to explain, let alone take in and understand. But suffice to say...
sorry. Can you say that again? Because I think that is a perfect summation of Lost.
All of this is really hard to explain, let alone take in and understand.
Perfect.
So suffice to say... We as viewers are meant to go, all right. So, but, you know, you can't help but demand answers as to who she is. Where does she come from? How did she do all this?
Why was she the guardian of the island?
But why was the monster a cloud of black smoke that made mechanical noises?
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah.
Where did the island and all its properties come from? Who were the very original inhabitants? Who built the temple? Tell us.
So I think it's a problem that is happening more and more now with, you know, Reddit being such a hive of just, you know, super smart people speculating constantly, like 24/7 about stuff. So Westworld is kind of like a show similar to Lost at the moment in terms of, you know, the fan fervor and people being obsessed with it. And they said recently that they had a twist plan for season two that was related to something from season one.
Yeah.
Fans on Reddit had already worked it out, so they had to change the scripts.
Yeah.
I think that's what happened with Lost. Because
people guessed things.
Obviously, the smoke monster was meant to be a cloud of nanobots.
Yeah.
That's why it made the clicking and all that sort of stuff. People went, a cloud of nanobots, is it? And then they were like, what? No, definitely not. And then they just made up some other nonsense because people kept guessing. And they were like, I know this annoys you. And I know it wasn't that they were dead all along. And I know even in the final season, they kind of were dead all along, but only in the final season, not in the whole show. But do you reckon originally they might have had that like, in their back pocket? And then people guessed that. So they were like, nah, definitely not. It never was that.
Yeah. But at least they didn't do a Harry Met Your Mother and just stuck to their guns where they picked a finale which they wanted to do in season two.
But it made no sense given everything that happened in the interim.
They didn't realise it would last for 9 seasons and they fucked up.
And that, kids, is How I Met Your Mother.
Yeah, so The Island, The Monster, Jacob, Man in Black, these are the things that Lost is actually technically all about.
Mm.
Yet you never really got an explanation about any of it.
No.
You only find out about it like at the last minute.
Yeah.
And then that's it.
Yeah.
And you get, sorry, what?
Yeah.
You're trying to prove me wrong, aren't you?
You are wrong.
Am I? They come, fight, they destroy, they corrupt. It always ends the same.
It only ends once. Anything that happens before that, it's just progress.
Again, someone got thrown into a magic cave.
Yeah. And when you don't...
It's got the same level of logical consistency as Aladdin.
Yeah. And I will admit, if you look up that guy's blog that we mentioned at the beginning...
Mm.
And you read all of it, you will kind of go, I guess that makes sense. That's all great. That all makes sense in my head. But you've come up with that.
That's just this guy making it up.
And that's great.
Yeah.
If that was true, if Cuse and Lindelof said, yep, he's right.
Yeah.
Cool. But they haven't. And
do you know what? They probably should.
They should.
Because he's come up with better explanations there. They should go, that's obviously what we intended all along. Well done. You've cracked the code.
So I'm sure none of that made sense. But I do have a lot of honourable mentions. Which I won't delve into. I'm just going to list a load of questions.
Okay.
And the way I've written it sort of feels like the bit, you know, in Shaun of the Dead.
Yeah.
Finest Hour, what's his name?
Ray Spall. When Ray Spall questions Simon Pegg, Shaun, he has a particular sort of shitty tone in his voice where he says, I thought it says on a social gathering. How come you're not speak to your dad?
Hey, whoa, I'm 29, for Christ's sakes. How old are you? 20, 21?
17.
So it's kind of impossible to not read these without being shitty.
Without doing it in the Riff's Ball.
So there's plenty of them.
Yeah.
What were the rules that were spoken by Ben Widmore, Man in Black, and Jacob? Remember the rules?
Nah.
You just hear Ben go, he broke the rules. What were they? Why bring it up if you're not going to explain what they are?
Bro code.
Maybe. Where did the glass eye come from? Remember the glass eye?
What's the glass eye?
In like the hatch, or one of the many hatches they found... They made a point of focusing on this glass eye they found. Like,
right.
Who's that? What does that mean? What's that going to do? No.
Who's that?
And do you remember there was a guy called Mikhail? He was this Russian dude.
Mikhail who had
an eye patch.
And he kept coming back from the dead. And that was never explained either.
We presumed that the eye maybe belonged to him. Never said so, though.
Right.
Just say it was.
Yeah.
Just how hard was it to go, oh yeah, I heard you found my glass eye. Done. Sorted. That's what it needed to do.
Yeah.
Who built the statue?
Yeah.
Egyptians, probably. But, you know. Why did Radzinski make the blast door map and shoot himself? So, in the hatch, there was a blast door map. When certain lights were turned on, you could see a big map of the island and all these kind of stuff.
Yeah.
It was awesome and cool at the time. Like, oh my God, it said Cerebrus on it. Maybe that meant that's what the smoke monster was.
Who did that?
We knew that was Radzinski that did it. Why did he do it? How did he know all this? Right. Why did he kill himself? Never explained. Don't worry about it. It's fine. Why did Penny know... Why did...
you were too shitty that you made yourself laugh.
Why did Penny know so much about the island?
Penny.
Money, apparently.
I love you, Penny.
With enough money.
I've always loved you.
With enough money and determination, anyone could do anything. That's not a good answer. Why does she know so much about the island?
That's why Donald Trump became president. That doesn't explain why she knows so much about the island.
Why can the Man in Black only appear as those who have died? Why?
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 Who made the secret door that supposedly summons the Man in Black? Right.
It was a secret door that summoned the Man in Black.
So bear in mind that later on it's revealed that Ben knows fuck all about anything. He doesn't know. And that's why he kills Jacob, because he's like, I've followed your teachings, and yet I've finally met you, and I realise I don't know anything. I don't know about the Man in Black. I don't know about the Smoke Monster. I know nothing. Yet, under his...
So Ben is very much like an angry Lost fan.
Yeah. But before that, under his house, which was built on temple shit, he knew of this thing where if he released something, it would summon the Smoke Monster. How did it summon the Smoke Monster when we find out later it's just the Man in Black fucking about?
Yeah.
And B, how did Ben know about that when he wasn't told about it by anyone? Did they introduce that and go, let's just pretend that no one remembers that bit. Let's just hope that everyone just glosses over it.
Well, I think they didn't remember.
I think they just forgot they did it.
I think they just forgot.
Because it makes no sense.
That explains a lot.
Why did Frank, Ben and Son not travel through time now?
Oh, have you got one for this?
No.
Oh, you seem very good. You're like, now.
I'm trying to explain it.
Oh, right.
You know how... when... Jack and Son and Ben and Locke's dead body.
Yeah.
They went back. This is when they'd been in the real world for a while.
And then they returned and they realised
they've got to go back to the island.
Yeah.
Kate as well. They get on a...
Kate.
Your great Matthew Fox impression.
Kate.
What's
Kate.
The other one?
The only... I can't do Matthew Fox. The only word I can say is... Kate.
No, there's the other bit where...
I can't remember the context when he goes...
What happened to your wife in the end? No. What happened to that girl you're talking about?
I married her!
Is she okay? The girl.
It doesn't matter.
What happened to her?
It doesn't matter.
How can you say it doesn't...
I married her!
I married her!
I married her!
Which is very similar to...
So it's... There's that great bit in Lost where Matthew Fox screams, "I married her," which is on YouTube, I think, as a classic example of
acting.
Matthew Fox is great acting. Yeah. And so there's always an associated video, which is from sort of a Lost wannabe, Flash Forward, which is, I think, literally called, in that case, Joseph Fiennes' terrible acting in Flash Forward. And there's a scene in Flash Forward where... Penny from Lost has one of them had a flash forward that she was having sex with Jack Davenport, British gent Jack Davenport in the future. So Joseph Fiennes comes home and for some reason Jack Davenport is in his house and he's furious. He's like, the man you're gonna be sleeping with in 6 months' time was in our house and I didn't invite him in. You did.
Don't you turn this around and make it about me. The man you might be sleeping with in 6 months' time was just in our living room, and I sure as hell didn't bring him into our lives. You did!
Come on, Mark!
What's the other one?
Be honest with me!
There's another bit.
The other bit is when I think it's the most famous moment in all Flash Forward history.
If you can remember anything about Flash Forward, it's this.
Is when Joseph Fiennes' character is an alcoholic. And in his flash forward, he can't remember anything.
His
boss is like, "Why is your flash forward so blurry? Why can't you remember anything?" Yeah. To which Joseph Fiennes says, "Because I was loaded, okay?
Because I was loaded, okay?"
And then there's this sort of lingering bit where both of them sort of look at each other, shocked and horror, going... like it was meant to be this powerful Emmy-winning scene.
Yeah.
Anyway,
check. Anyway, we're going off topic, but check those clips out. Yeah, they're remarkable.
But yeah, the point was, when they were going back to the island, some of them flashed back to the 70s and some didn't. Frank, let me beat ass.
All right, looks like I've almost got this. All I got to do is just take these two wires here and just pull them apart like this and... Oh, dear. Well, I guess I don't know anything about defusing bombs. Does anyone have a plan B?
Dude, I know. What do you guys say we just skip all this and meet up in an elaborate purgatory? That way we can live happily ever after. Is that really an option?
Oh, it's totally an option.
Lapidus! So they went back in time.
So they crashed on the island again, purposely.
Yeah.
But Jack Hurley, was it?
Right.
Kate, they flashed back to the 70s.
Right.
Where Sawyer and everyone was in Dark.
Right, I don't remember this, okay.
Whereas Son, Frank and Ben were in the present day.
Okay.
But it's never explained why did Son not go back? Why? Was it just so you prolonged Son and Jin finally reuniting again?
Yeah. Because then that was really emotional.
Don't worry about it, not explaining. Who built the magic lighthouse and how the hell did it work?
I remember the magic lighthouse.
So the lighthouse...
And that was something they introduced right at the end.
Right at the end.
These are our names.
Turn it to 23 degrees.
Oh, I don't think Jacob wants.
What? What is that?
It's my house. It's the house I grew up in.
So the reason all of the Losties arrived on the island was because they were candidates chosen by Jacob over a part of time.
Yeah.
He kept just going back to the real world. Don't know how he did it.
It was basically like a really fancy version of The Apprentice.
Yeah. And he assigned numbers to each one and somehow used this magical lighthouse to see into the world and find where they are and somehow travel there. How did it work? Don't worry about it.
What about that weird little wheel that Ben had?
The
frozen donkey wheel.
Yeah. That's how the polar bears got found in the desert, because they used polar bears to sort of move the wheel and they just got transported through electromagnetism to Tunisia.
How are we going to explain this nonsense? Some other nonsense, I imagine.
Yeah, don't worry about it.
This is electromagnetism seems to be the lost version of, like, radiation in 60s Marvel comics, where they'd be like, how to get powers? Radiation. Oh, that'll definitely give you superpowers, not cancer.
Why did the man in black kill the innocent Ajira flight passengers? So the Ajira flight was the one I just mentioned where they all went back.
They had to go back.
So, because on that plane, it wasn't just Jack and those guys, it was a load of random people just going on holiday.
Going on play, yeah.
They all got murdered by the man in black. Why?
It was just a dick.
But did you have to include that? Couldn't you have made it a private plane? Why did it have to be?
Well, also they knew that they were going back to the island.
Yeah, so they knew they were going to crash.
They must have known there was at least a good chance they would crash. Quite selfish of them. Charter a private plane.
And a weird one was David Shepherd a real person in the Flash Sideways universe? Now, David Shepherd was a little scroat who's now in 13 Reasons Why.
Yeah,
it was Jack's son in the Flash Sideways. Yeah. So he doesn't really exist. Who was he?
That's a very good point.
Why did they bother creating him?
But because it's all paranormal and shit, could that not have... No, wait, that doesn't make any sense.
No.
I was going to say, could he have... You know, like in... niche reference here. But if you've ever seen A Christmas Carol starring Ross Kemp...
Yeah,
The sort of modern-day update of the Dickens classic. He sees the Ghost of Christmas future, and it's just this little kid.
Yeah.
And then later on in sort of the flash forward, you find out that that's actually his son who had, like, projected himself into the past.
Oh, maybe.
So it's like, maybe Jack in his weird flash sideways universe saw what his son would later be. But that doesn't make any sense, because Jack dies before he has a son.
Exactly.
So it can't be that.
No, because in the flash sideways universe...
In fact, you can probably cut that whole reference to Ross Kemp's Christmas Carol, because it turns out I was talking shit.
I'm keeping it in just for the reference of Ross Kemp.
I'd like to see him come at me with all that I'm a hard bastard stuff. I'd say, put the baseball bat down. Send the minders home. It's just you and me, skin on skin, stripped to the waist.
But in the Flash Sideways one, he's married to Juliet for some bizarre reason, and he's got a kid with her.
Yeah.
Why? Why bother making that? Yeah. Why go out of your way to bring that in?
Yeah.
And then, so did he just die?
Yeah.
Did they just kill him?
I mean, you're looking at me like I've got the answers, and I don't.
Tell me what's going on. That's it. So I feel stressed and sweaty.
You know, do you remember, this is a while back, older listeners may remember.
Yeah.
Do you remember when we did the Freaky Film franchises episode?
Yeah.
That's quite hard to say. And we were talking about the God of Gamblers series. Yeah. And at the end of it, I said to you... That was the biggest load of unintelligible nonsense, and we'll never do that again.
I have to admit, I think
this is the most incomprehensible episode of Two Geeks ever made.
I am concerned.
Yeah,
there's a chance that this episode will be scrapped entirely, because listening to myself now, I'm thinking, why would anyone want to listen to this?
Yeah, it was the ramblings of a madman.
So if you're still here,
well done.
Thank you so much.
Well done.
I'm guessing the reason you're listening is because you're a Lost fan. You've seen all of it, and so it makes sense. If you've never seen Lost in your life, good on you. Well done. You must really like us, because I don't know why you're still here.
Cheers.
Yeah, thanks for that.
You just like listening to drunk people ramble.
Yeah. Anyway, that's Lost for you.
So much more Two Geeks to come.
So that's about it. Thanks again for joining us.
As always.
As ever, we're on Facebook and Twitter, which is at Two Geeks Cast. So please give us a follow on there. Please give us some reviews and things on iTunes.
Yes, so all our previous episodes are on iTunes, all 28 of them.
Mm-hmm.
Please, rate, review, subscribe.
Yeah.
We would really, really appreciate it. Please. That was pathetic. Just begging. But please do. Yeah. And also, you can find all our previous episodes on our website, which is twogeeks2beers.com.
And you can also contact us, please do, with any sort of requests for shows or beer options or anything you want. Tell us how great we are.
Tell us how great we are.
Which is podcast@twogeeks2beers.com.
Send us an email.
I will leave you, though, for now, with a song which has become synonymous with Lost. I was going to go for Drive Shaft, Charlie's fictional band.
We are,
but
everybody.
It's a shit song.
It is a terrible
song. So I'm going to go with Mama Cass with Make Your Own Kind of Music, which was the song which kicked off season 2, which was amazing at the time, because at the end of season 1, you were like, what's down the hatch?
Yeah.
What are you looking at? And then it started off with some dude you never met, later revealed to be Desmond, just having a great time down the hatch, listening to this on the vinyl. It's a great song. So yes. Every time I hear it, I just think, oh, Lost. Memories of Lost being brilliant.
Oh, let's get our Desmond on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Need to lie down now, to be honest.
Nobody can tell you there's only one song worth singing. They may try and sell you